Hey guys, Taki here. Today we're going to cover one of the most talked about issues that I've seen since I started this channel 2 years ago. If you've been into emulation on Android phones or dedicated handhelds for any length of time, you've probably heard the claim that the platform as a whole is bad for emulation due to high input lag. These claims can come in a few common flavors depending on the standpoint of the person that is making them, but they typically center around either not considering the purchase of an Android device because the input latency is too high, or that Linux handhelds are superior because there's far less overhead from the system and less input lag on the whole. The history of this problem dates back to the early days of Android phones, and it's a little out of the scope of this video to do a deep dive into all of the nuances, but I do want to establish a frame of reference, so we are on the same page for what I hope to cover in this video. When we talk about input lag, three primary factors can impact perceived or actual input lag. The first is the type of input device that you are using and how it is connected to your Android device. I think the most common method for doing this historically has been via Bluetooth due to the wide support and lack of cables required. The problem is that the Bluetooth spec is ever-changing, and not all Bluetooth controllers have the same base latency. Where things are on a more level playing field is when we're using devices with a hardwired set of buttons or a controller that is connected directly to a USB port. Other things can get in the way, even under these circumstances, from the input drivers being used to the frequency that the system pulls for input. Generally speaking, this would provide you with the best base latency across the board. The second factor that impacts perceived or actual input lag is the processing power of the device and the emulators that we can use with said power. If we take a situation where two devices are using identical controllers and identical emulators, but the performance gap between them is such that one device has more headroom for system functions while running the game, it is understandable that the more powerful device will process input commands faster and have less total input latency as a result. There are also other situations where a more powerful processor will allow you to use more optimized emulators with less input latency. There are also latency compensation options that require a lot of processing power. The third and final factor is the inherent latency in the panel itself. 60 FPS games will refresh at 16.66 millisecond intervals no matter what screen you're using. So, this factor is only ever a problem when we're dealing with a screen that has a slow response rate or when there is something else in the signal chain. That brings us to the point of this video and the ultimate question that I hope to finally put to rest. Is input latency on Android as severe as it is claimed to be? And if the claim does end up being true, how far is the input latency gap between an Android and a Linux device? I hope you're ready, because we're about to go down the rabbit hole. For this test, I have two popular devices in front of me, and I want to explain the methodology behind the test that I'm about to do. These devices have two big similarities. The first is that their input mechanism is nearly identical, being that the controls are on the same PCB as the processor. The second is that they both have enough power to comfortably run low-end systems with a reasonable amount of extra headroom to spare for the system. One of these devices is more powerful than the other, but I do not expect that it'll have any impact on the test cases that I've picked. The device on the left is the Retroid Pocket 2 Plus running on Android 9. It has a quad-core processor with a single A75 core and three A55 cores. Again, this is the more powerful device of the two, but it should not have any impact on the systems that we're testing. The device on the right is the RG351P running on a Linux OS. This has a quad-core processor with four A35 cores, and I picked this device because it's one of the most popular Linux handhelds in the market today. As you may have noticed, there are wires connected to an LED on both of these devices. This LED is wired directly to the circuit of one input button on both devices, and it will light up the moment that an electrical signal is sent from a button press. I think you can get where we're going with this one, and I have to say, I have been looking forward to doing this test for months. So, let's explain how we're going to do this test. To control as many variables as possible, we will use the same game on the same emulator core inside RetroArch on both devices. To measure input latency, we will use the Show Frames option inside RetroArch on both devices while we record the test footage in slow motion. We will press our wired input button inside a game and then count the frames in slow motion from the exact frame that the LED light turns on until we see the character sprite move on screen. After that, we will take our total frames and multiply them by 16.66 to get our input latency in milliseconds. I want this data to be as robust as possible, so we will run this test on three different retro systems with low CPU requirements to give both devices an equal chance at success. I want to point out that I have not done this test before doing this voiceover. I have no idea how this video is going to turn out, but I do want to share my hypothesis. I don't know which device will have the lowest input latency, but I do not believe that the gap between them will be significant enough to crown one platform as the king over the other. If this is not the case, I will be extremely shocked. Not shocked enough to swear off Android devices, but shocked. To keep things interesting, I encourage you to put your hypothesis down in the comments below without watching further into this video and see if you're correct. There's no way to police this, but I think it can be interesting if you're not worried about being wrong. With that out of the way, let's jump into the first test. For our first system, we're going to use SNES with the SNES 9X current core. We're going to film the test as it happens, but the results will show up at the end of the section. Let's start off with Android. Now, let's go over to Linux. For the Super Nintendo test section, the Android device had an input latency of 66.64 milliseconds in both games. The Linux device also had an input latency of 66.64 milliseconds in both games. For our second system, we have NES using the Nestopia core in RetroArch. This time, let's start off with Linux. Now, let's go over to Android. For the NES test section, the Linux device had an input latency of 66.64 milliseconds in both games. The Android device had an average input latency of 75 milliseconds in both games. Now, let's move on to our final test. For this system, we're going to use GBA with the MGBA core in RetroArch. Our test ROM is going to be Metroid Fusion. We're going to do this a bit differently and start this test off with an actual GBA. Obviously, we don't have an LED wired for this, nor do we have a frame counter, so this won't be as accurate as our other testing devices, but I wanted to include it nevertheless. Now, let's head over to Android. And finally, we have Linux. For the GBA test section, our Android device had an input latency of 66.64 milliseconds. As you can probably guess by now, the Linux device also had an input latency of 66.64 milliseconds. And this final one isn't as accurate as the other two, but the GBA itself had an input latency of 33.32 milliseconds. So, there we have it. We finally have an updated answer to the most frequently talked about issue in the YouTube comment section. I can't say that I'm that surprised by these results, because I've long said that modern Android devices do not have excessive input latency, especially when compared to Linux handhelds. Except for Super Nintendo, the two devices experience the same delay. In the situation where the Android device had more delay, it had more to do with when the input was processed during the current frame that was being displayed more than anything else. If your input is sent too close to the end of a frame, you might have an additional frame of lag waiting for the input to be shown. As a bonus, I'll point out that I tried this same kind of test on a gaming phone with an incredibly high touch sampling rate using touch controls, and the lowest delay that I was able to measure was between 16 and 41 milliseconds. The best I got on the RP2 Plus using the best options in RA for latency reduction was 33 milliseconds. I did the same test on a PC, and the lowest delay that I was able to measure with a USB controller was between 25 and 41 milliseconds. Now that the test is done, I'm interested to know your thoughts down below. Obviously, there's more that I could have done by testing against native hardware for all three systems, but we only care about the differences between these two platforms in this situation, not the differences between them in actual hardware. It might also be cool to test a single device with great Linux and Android support to eliminate more variables. I'm interested to know if your earlier prediction ended up being correct. Let me know down below, and if you have any other questions, leave those down below as well. If you enjoyed this content, please consider subscribing to the channel. It helps out a lot. I have other videos like this on the horizon, and you won't want to miss them. Happy gaming, everyone. Talk you out.